In this video, we will review the basic anatomy of the elbow. The elbow is a synovial joint composed of the humerus, the ulna, and the radius. We will review this joint from anterior, posterior, lateral, medial, and transverse viewpoints. We will progress gradually, starting with the most relevant structures of the osseous anatomy, then working through the cartilage, the synovial capsule, and ending with the ligaments. We will start with the osseous architecture. The distal end of the humerus widens in the frontal plane and is called the condyle of the humerus, according to the anatomical nomenclature. It has two articular surfaces, the trochlea and the capitulum. The trochlea is in contact with the ulna. Like all trochlea, it has a groove in the sagittal plane. Its medial region is more prominent than the lateral region. The capitulum is lateral to the trochlea. Clinically, it is frequently referred to as the condyle, which is how I will call it from now on. It is a convex surface that articulates with the articular fovea of the head of the radius. The trochlea and the condyle are separated by a discrete groove. In a lateral view, we can see that the articular portion curves anteriorly and is anterior to the midline of the shaft. In the extra-articular region, we can see the epitrochlea, the epicondyle, and the medial and lateral supracondylar crests. The epitrochlea, or medial epicondyle, is proximal to the trochlea. It is where the medial collateral ligament inserts proximally, and it is more prominent than the lateral epicondyle. The lateral epicondyle is proximal to the condyle. The lateral collateral ligament inserts proximally into its most posterior region. The medial supracondylar crest is the proximal continuation of the epitrochlea. The lateral supracondylar crest is the proximal continuation of the lateral epicondyle. Anteriorly, we can see the coronoid fossa, which houses the coronoid process of the ulna during maximum flexion. Laterally, we can see the radial fossa, which is more shallow and houses the head of the radius during maximum flexion. The olecranon fossa marks the posterior surface, which receives the olecranon during maximum extension. To review, on the lateral side we can observe the condyle and the epicondyle. Then, looking through the bone, we would see the olecranon fossa and the coronoid fossa. The proximity of these two makes the bone very thin in this region. We'll now move on to the ulna. The proximal end of the ulna articulates with the humeral trochlea in the trochleal notch. The trochlear notch is the major concavity which articulates with the humerus. The coronoid process marks the anterior limit of the trochlear notch. Distal to the coronoid process is the tuberosity of the ulna for the insertion of the brachialis muscle. The most proximal end of the ulna is called the olecranon, where the triceps is inserted. In the anterior view, we can see that the medial region of the trochlear recess is larger. The sublime tubercle is located in this region, which is the insertion site of the anterior portion of the medial collateral ligament. In the lateral view, we can see the location of the recess for the head of the radius. Moving distally, we can see the triangular fossa, which is the insertion site of the deep portion of the supinator muscle. The triangular fossa is continuous with the supine crest, where the lateral collateral ligament is inserted. In the posterior view, we can see how the olecranon continues distally with the posterior edge of the ulna. Moving on to the radius, the proximal end of the radius is formed by the head, which is, simply put, circular on the axial plane and has a slight concave proximal surface, which is called the articular fossa. The head is followed by the neck, where the diameter of the radius somewhat decreases. The bicipital tuberosity is located on the neck of the radius for the insertion of the distal tendon of the brachial biceps. The body of the radius follows the neck. In the lateral view, we see that the radial notch of the ulna is located in the most anterior region. This conditions the position of the bones such that the diaphysis of the radius is positioned anteriorly to the ulna. Now we will see where the cartilage is located in the elbow. The cartilage covers the articular surfaces of these three bones. In the case of the humerus, the entire trochlea and the condyle on its anterior and distal surface are covered with cartilage. Thus, the condyle only has cartilage in the anterior and distal regions. As for the radius, the head is covered by cartilage on its proximal surface for contact with the humeral condyle, and on its circular perimeter for contact with the radial notch of the ulna and the annular ligament, which we will see later on. Likewise, the entire posterior region of the trochlea is covered with cartilage, hidden here by the olecranon. The posterior region of the condyle has no cartilage since, at maximum extension, the head of the radius articulates with the distal region of the condyle, not with its posterior region. This area serves as an entry region for vascularization at the distal end of the humerus. Once again, in the lateral view, we can see that the radial head is covered with cartilage on its proximal surface for contact with the humeral condyle, and on its circular perimeter for contact with the radial notch of the ulna and the annular ligament. Medially, the trochlear notch of the ulna is also covered with cartilage, although there is normally a transverse groove running through its center without cartilage. Moving on, we will now see the synovial capsule. The elbow has a single synovial capsule for the three articular combinations it has between the humerus, the ulna, and the radius. As a general rule, the synovial capsule inserts into the margin of the articular surface. However, anteriorly, it includes the coronoid fossa and the radial fossa of the distal end of the humerus. On the ulna, the synovial capsule includes the coronoid process. And at the proximal end of the radius, it includes approximately 1 centimeter on the neck area, thus forming the saxiform recess, which is deep to the annular ligament. Posteriorly, the synovial capsule includes the olecranon fossa. The olecranon bursa is located in the posterior region. It is a synovial tissue that is separated from the joint synovial capsule, and it allows the skin to slide on the elbow. Finally, we will see the ligaments of the elbow. The trochlea is stabilized by 2 collateral ligaments. The medial, or ulnar, collateral ligament is composed of 3 portions that originate from the distal region of the epitrochlea, not from the medial surface. Medially, we see how the anterior portion of the medial collateral ligament inserts distally into the sublime tubercle. It is the most biomechanically relevant of the 3 parts of the ligament, and remains in tension during extension. The posterior portion inserts distally into the medial surface of the olecranon and is tensioned during flexion. Joining these 2 portions in the distal region are some intermediate fibers. The lateral, or radial, collateral ligament inserts into the lateral and distal region of the lateral epicondyle, and is directed posteriorly and laterally to the head of the radius. Posteriorly, we see that it actually inserts into the supine crest of the ulna, not into the radius. That is why it is also called the lateral ulnar collateral ligament. It is more appropriate to observe this ligament in the posterior view, where we see that it surrounds the head of the radius with its posterior component. In order to ensure the stability of the trochlea during flexion and extension, independent of pronosupinatory movements, it is necessary that the lateral collateral ligament be inserted into the ulna and not into the radius. The proximal radio-ulnar joint is mainly stabilized by the annular ligament, which originates from the anterior margin of the radial fossa, surrounds the head of the radius, and inserts into the posterior margin of the radial fossa. Some fibers that originate in the epicondyle and are directed anteriorly insert into the annular ligament, not into the radial head. By looking at a section that passes through the distal radial ulnar joint, we can get a better understanding of how the annular ligament originates from the anterior margin of the radial notch of the ulna, surrounds the head of the radius, and is inserted into the posterior margin of the same radial notch of the ulna. With this osteoarticular framework, the head of the radius rotates around its central axis during pronation and supination. The quadrate ligament originates in the neck of the radius and inserts into the proximal region of the supinator fossa. Between the two bones, the interosseous membrane joins the interosseous edge of the ulna and the radius. Its fibers are directed from the ulna to the radius, distal to the radial neck, in a distal to proximal direction. They thus limit the proximal axial migration of the radius. The oblique cord is formed by fibers, which are perpendicular to those of the interosseous membrane. They originate in the ulnar tuberosity and insert into the radius distal to the bicipital tuberosity.